Hello class, this is Derek Fugio presenting my third unit presentation for Music 601 under Dr. Barbara McLean. Community Sings, Americans United in Song. So what is community singing? In a 1916 article in the Music Supervisors National Convention yearbook, Peter Dykema begins by describing what he thinks community singing is not. Dykema labels this antithesis of community singing informal group singing, in which a group of people come together and, for some reason or another, decide to sing. It is occasionally haphazard, there is no clear leadership, and the musical product is not the primary importance. In contrast, what he terms community singing requires a very large group of participants. They're often brought together as an informal collective. That is, the participants that are singing do not know each other beforehand. The only reason they are associated at the time is for the purpose of coming together to sing. In addition, there is a clear leader because the size of the group dictates some sort of coordination for a good performance. There may be well-arranged accompaniment, either the piano or some sort of ensemble music. And finally, the quality and aesthetic of the musical product being generated is of utmost importance. Who is Peter Dykema? Peter William Dykema was a teacher at this time at the University of Wisconsin. As a member of the Music Supervisors National Conference, he was tasked with the editorship of the Music Supervisors Bulletin, the periodical of the conference. Through his tireless efforts and volunteering of his own energies and time, he was able to expand the networking and professional development aspects of the publication. In 1913, he presented a paper at the conference that suggested the creation of a core repertoire of vocal music that all Americans should learn and be able to sing. The Mu Phi Alpha Symphonia Fraternity, of which Dykema eventually became supreme president, has the following to say about the man on their biography of him. Supreme President Peter W. Dykema was a strong believer in the power of music to unify a community and actively promoted and encouraged community singing. So where did community singing come from? Dykema is the first to admit that he and the MSNC did not invent community singing, but that this occurrence was happening throughout the United States before and after the publication of this paper. Dykema went on to describe what he felt the origins of community singing was, and as many of you can see, many of these traditions are alive today. He cited religious and church singing, the singing of hymns and school songs at convocations and commencements, the opening and closing songs at professional assemblies and conventions, and the singing of school songs and fight songs at pep rallies and athletic events. World events would forever change the course of community singing in America. In 1914, the Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated, beginning World War I. At the same time, the MSNC committee, along with Dykema, were in deliberations as to which songs would be included in this pamphlet. They eventually agreed on a series of 18 songs, which included America, Annie Laurie, Auld Lang Syne, Drink to Me Only with Thine Eyes, and others, which were part of a common national music heritage to which many Americans could identify. As the war progressed and America's involvement in the action increased, the MSNC Community Music Committee expanded the 18 original songs to include 55 new songs and choruses. This included works by George M. Cohan and Irving Berlin, patriotic American songs, and Christmas carols. By the time America joined the war in 1918, the Liberty Edition was released, including a revised version of the national anthem that was produced specifically for the purpose of making the song singable by the common person. This new edition sold over 1.5 million copies within the first 2 years alone. This article from the Journal of Education, 1918, shows the extent to which the United States federal government leveraged the arts, and music in particular, to mobilize the American public towards the service of the war effort. Under Walter Damrosch, the United States War Department fully standardized, modernized, promoted, and funded all of the service bands so that they could help support patriotism and morale in the war effort. The Navy Department, in addition to training their sailors, also taught all the sailors to sing service songs and shanties. But most notably, this article mentions two specific concerts of community singing that were particularly notable. On the occasion of a Pershing's army victory over St. Mihiel, a small group of singers began singing the national anthem in the City Park of New York. Their numbers quickly grew, and eventually there were more than 20,000 singers involved. At a concert at the Boston Commons, over 40,000 participants engaged in the singing of hymns and patriotic and seasonal songs. The immediate significance of the community singing movement were as follows. Through the publication of these works at the height of their popularity, the MSNC was able to create a number of songbooks that codified and standardized a body of American music that was widespread among students in schools as well as the community outside those walls. The action of community singing increased morale and patriotism and helped ease the country through the hardships of war. The community singing movement also increased support for the MSNC by increasing its visibility and membership, and also promoted the cause of music education in the schools. And finally, this movement promoted the birth of cultural literacy through a national repertory of songs known, understood, and sung by a majority of Americans. What relevance does the community singing movement have to music education today? In an article in the International Journal of Research in Choral Singing called The Update on Community Choirs and Singing in the United States, researchers looked at metadata generated by a number of surveys, including the National Endowments for the Arts Survey of Public Participation in the Arts. This document looks at adult participation in the arts, including music, theater, dance, drama, and the fine arts. We've looked at this piece of research in a number of Dr. McLean's other classes, and the results are very interesting. A majority of American adults participate more in choral singing than in any other genre of the arts, and it found that on average, the American choral singer is more highly educated, more charitable, and volunteered their time more often, were more aware of current events or tended to follow the news or read the newspaper, were high consumers of culture, including museums and public art performances, they voted regularly and were involved in the political process, and finally, were non-professional, non-music majors. While all of this data is corollary and not causal, it's interesting to see that many of the people that are highly engaged in community choral singing, much like the original community singers, tended to be more active citizens in their community. These findings could imply that even today, the qualities attributed to community singing and community singers still help people become better citizens and better members of the culture and nation to which they belong. As the wars came and went, the community singing movement came and went with them, generally rising and falling with crests of nationalism and national pride. Today, we still sing in large groups, at concerts, convocations, commencements, and sporting events, and any other time when the spirit moves us, but not with as much fervor or as collective energy as during the world wars. In recent times, instrumental music has followed suit in the community singing movement, instituting group public performances, such as this one. The Tuba Christmas Movement, founded by Bill Bell in 1974, has now grown to encompass all 50 states, providing performances of mass tuba euphonium ensembles of Christmas music once a year. The final thing I'd like to leave you with is this clip of Rosemary Clooney, the famed crooner, singing her last concert, recorded live with the Honolulu Symphony Pops under Matt Katengoob in 2001. Her final selection, God Bless America, was dedicated to the lives lost in the September 11th bombings, which occurred only months before this concert. After singing the first verse, Clooney invites the audience to sing along, and most of the voices in the Blaisdell Concert Hall rise to the task admirably. In my opinion, this is the pinnacle of both music education and community singing. A room full of people who have never met each other, but who are united in their common cultural, musical, and national experiences, raising their voices together in wonderful musical song. Thank you for your time.
Sing with me this chorus, okay? You know the words. To the prairies, to the ocean.